papa. Che soleil in balcone saranno. She got my jean naga. Chashingam ga jigo hewa genyang chan. Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, I'm Sebastian, a medical student from Australia. And it is currently a Saturday. It is about 10 o'clock right now. And we have just finished 2 weeks of our new rotation and we've learned a lot of new content. So it's just been 2 weeks of online lectures. There's a lot of topics to cover, a lot of things to review. So I'm gonna make a start on them now. So the new rotation is called Perinatal and Women's Health, and it encompasses a few different specialties, including obstetrics, which is the branch of medicine concerning childbirth and midwifery, gynecology, which is diseases and conditions affecting women and girls, especially those of the reproductive or endocrine system, and neonatology, which is looking after newborn babies. And so this is considered a specialty block compared to a general block, which is more like surgery and internal medicine. So there's a lot of content to cover because it's a lot of stuff that we haven't really been taught before, especially in our preclinical years, years one and two, we didn't get much exposure to these topics. So far, I've been finding it challenging, but also really interesting. And I'm gonna try crack onto a lecture or two and explain how the rest of the term works. So as you can see, I have made a Notion page for the new rotation, and I've got a list of all the online pre-recorded lectures. So these were lectures from previous years, and I've divided them into the different specialties, so obstetrics, gynecology, and neonatology. I'm currently up to contraception, and I've got the lecture on the other page here, so I'll make a start on it now. All right, so just finished one of the lectures, and apart from these previous years' pre-recorded lectures, we've actually had a set schedule for these past 2 weeks, which consists pretty much of back-to-back lectures through the day, and they'll start from somewhere between 8 a.m. to 10 a.m, and they've been finishing at around 3 to 6 p.m. And they've been covering a whole range of concepts, things like STIs and pelvic inflammatory disease, neonatal x-rays, antepartum and postpartum hemorrhage, menopause, ectopic pregnancy, pretty much like all the themes that you'd expect in obstetrics and gynecology. And the reason why they're doing this is because next week when we go onto the wards, we'll be seeing things like this and we'll need to have had some prerequisite knowledge. And so we can be more engaged and ask more questions when we're speaking to the doctors, the midwives and the nurses, and it'll be just more beneficial for our learning. So I'm gonna keep moving on with the lectures, and the next one is infertility. So I made myself a quick iced latte. I'm not a huge fan of the bitter taste that coffee has, so I prefer to have it with a lot of milk and in this form because it tastes a little bit nicer, I think. But anyways, what I wanted to talk about was the reason why our lectures are now being delivered through Zoom in an online format. Normally we'd have them in person, we'd be able to go to the hospital and see the lecturers and really get that hands-on experience, be able to see all our classmates. But currently Sydney is in lockdown, and we are in lockdown until the end of the month, until August the 28th, which means that we have restrictions to visitors, so no visitors are allowed, and we're only allowed to go to the shops to get essential groceries and stuff like that. And we're only allowed to exercise with a maximum of 2 people. So I went and played tennis with a friend last week, and that would be considered okay, but if you were trying to do an 11-a-side soccer game, that wouldn't be allowed. And what that has meant for us as medical students is that firstly, lectures are now online compared to in person, and it's gonna change the clinical experience when we go to the hospital part of the rotation next week. Normally we'd be able to go around different departments, so for example, shadowing a midwife and doing home visits, or being able to go to the gynecological theaters. Yes, we'd be able to still do some of that, but it's restricted. And so there's no home visits now. A lot of these surgeries, and in particular the non-urgent elective surgeries, are all postponed until the end of lockdown. And there'll be restrictions into clinics. So a lot of people won't be coming into the hospital. There'll be a lot of telehealth consults, and it's really gonna change how we interact with patients and how many people are allowed to be on the wards seeing patients. The reason why we're still able to go to hospital is because we're considered an essential education meaning that we need to be able to go to the hospital on a rotation in order to learn. Another requirement is that in order to attend our hospital placement, we have to have had a COVID vaccination. And so if you haven't had one yet or are not planning to, then you won't be able to attend. That sort of affected me because I was late to the party when it came to receiving my vaccination. I'm double vaccinated now, but I didn't get it until last month. And this was before the news of all the lockdown changes. So definitely affected a lot of people in a lot of ways. I hope you're keeping safe, keeping to the your local government area guidelines, safe hygiene practices, wearing masks, and hopefully if you have access to getting the vaccination, I'd urge you to get it. I think it's important that everybody gets it. But onto different things. It is approaching lunchtime and I haven't really got heaps of stuff done, so I better get back to it. So I just finished going through about four lectures. The last one was on cervical cancer. And what's interesting is that the incidence of cervical cancer in Australia now is, I think, about 5.5 in 100,000, which is one of the lowest across the developed nations. And I think that's mainly due to things like the National Cervical Screening Program and also the availability of the HPV vaccination, which is offered to children in high school, both boys and girls. And I think the HPV vaccination, Gardasil, was invented by an Australian physician, so that's pretty cool. With these lectures, I feel that if you're only doing lectures the whole day, you will go absolutely insane. So I've been trying to break them up using different resources, and I'm a big fan of doing practice questions. So I'm gonna try crack out as many questions as I can before lunchtime. So before I start any study session, I always like to have a Pomodoro timer in the background. So I'm using this website called PomoFocus, which is pretty good, to set a 50-minute timer. I also have some classical music ready to play in the background, and that will put me in the mood to really focus. Alright guys, so I thought I'd quickly show you what an example question could look like. Ignore my terrible score of 50%, but having a read, it says a 69-year-old female arrives into your clinic complaining of recent urgency to pass urine and increased frequency. This is followed by a leakage of urine. The urinary dipstick is negative and you don't suspect malignancy. The likely diagnosis is urgency urinary incontinence. With this in mind, what is the best initial option to manage this patient's condition? And the five options are bladder retraining, referral to a specialist for botulin injections, pelvic floor muscle training, prescribe oxybutynin, or advise her to use absorbent products and toileting aids. And so the question's asking, what is the best initial option to manage urge urinary incontinence? So urge urinary incontinence is usually overactivity of the detrusor muscle of the bladder. In terms of the first line treatment, you probably tell this lady that bladder retraining is one way to go about it. So that's trying to increase the intervals for when you have to go to the toilet. So let's select it, and when we select it, it's correct. Ooh, and 74% of people answered this correctly. Alright guys, so I picked up some food. Mum kindly made some sandwiches for lunch. Thanks, Mum. And I'm gonna have a quick study break. So I'm gonna watch some Netflix. I'm watching this show called Meteor Garden, which is this Chinese drama. It's a little bit corny, but as some of you guys would know, I've been learning Mandarin Chinese for over a year. And as all the polyglots online will tell you, that the best way to learn is to get exposed in the language. And if you guys are learning a language, one really cool Chrome extension that you can get is called Learning Languages with Netflix. It allows you to put two subtitles on the screen at one time. So in my case, it's English and simplified Chinese. If you want to study while watching TV, that's one way to do it. I just finished an episode and it's about 3 o'clock right now. And the reason why I take a break around this time of the day is because I found that mid-afternoons is when I get that afternoon low and I don't really focus well. And so if you guys are planning for a study day or preparing for an exam, I think it's important to work out when you're most focused and make sure that you study during that time. So right now I'm going to do a little bit of Chinese Anki and then I'll get back into the med lectures later on.
他昨天学习汉语了。
他昨天学习汉语了。
你有一百万美元的话，你会做什么？
你有一百万美元的话，你在做什？你会做什么？
Finished up all my daily Anki reviews and I've now changed scenery. I am sitting on this new couch that I got last week. I don't know if you guys could tell from the video. And my girlfriend Deb was teasing me saying that I'd never use the couch, I would never sit on it, it would just be here in the room serving no function, no, you know, real function. But here I am, I'm sitting in the couch, I'm using it. Just finished a set doing squats behind me. It's a leg day, which is probably my least favorite day because I find it the most physically tiring. I don't know, I get puffed out. Maybe I'm just unfit. So I finished reviewing some lectures earlier, managed to cover four of them, and it is now just a little after 7 o'clock. Gonna smash out this workout and then I'll probably grab dinner afterwards. So when it comes to training, I only really got back into sort of resistance training or weightlifting about 2 months ago, and I've been trying my best to do at least 3 times a week. My brother puts me to shame, he's in here 6 times a week, but I feel that 3 times, 4 times a week is something that's doable if you have a busy schedule, and there's always benefits to exercise, whether it be through cognitive health, improving bone health, feeling better, being in a good mood, and you know, if you go enough, you'll look better hopefully. That's my timer saying that I have another set to go to. So I'm gonna finish the rest of this workout and I'll see you guys after dinner. Alright guys, so I'm back in my room. I'm all nice and snug in the trusty blue hoodie. Deb and I actually ordered some new hoodies. We're getting these penguin ones, which she has in Canberra, but obviously because of lockdown, she can't come to visit yet. So when she comes back, I'll get them and you might see them in a future video. But it's about 8:30 right now. And the plan is I might try cover one or two more topics before about 10 o'clock. I will start with prenatal diagnosis and then do a little bit of urogynecology. Well, that's gonna wrap up all the study. I'll probably go on to play some video games and just chill for the rest of the night. But I hope this video gave you some study motivation. If you're preparing for an exam or working on assignment, best of luck. And I hope you guys are keeping safe and looking after yourself. If you enjoyed the video, be sure to hit that like button. Subscribe if you want to see more content like this. I'll put a link to a playlist with all my medical school vlogs if you want to check them out. And until next time, this was Sebastian. Stay sharp. Also, if you guys didn't notice, check out this thing. Came in the mail last week and I was pretty excited to put it up. So. Anyways, thanks so much for all the support. See you next time.